Good afternoon, friends. As promised, I'm here with Mr. Jayesh Parekh, the famous venture capitalist, angel investor, the startups look up to, and a huge mentor. There are a lot of stories we'll get to hear from Jayesh. Son of soil from Kolkata, shifted to Singapore and made it big, and helping people to make it big. Yes, Jayesh. So good to see you here in Kolkata.
Thank you.
You keep coming to Kolkata and you see a lot of changes. So what is your take on this entire startup ecosystem here in Kolkata, and what is the difference that you see that in Kolkata and elsewhere where you are putting your money?
Thank you, Shoma, and thank you, Voice of Republic, for inviting me today for this interview. I'm always fascinated by Kolkata. I'm from Kolkata, and the warmth and the people and the vibrancy of Kolkata is always fascinating. You asked me a lot of questions in that one question, Shoma. But I think importantly, I think India itself in the entrepreneurship ecosystem has been doing extremely well, and it's suddenly like blossomed over these last few years. And certainly Kolkata is following. It is slightly behind, but it's obviously now catching up to Bangalore and Gurgaon and Delhi and Bombay and all these other places. I think this is natural because there are a lot of youth with ideas, tech, digital ideas in Kolkata and in West Bengal. And so therefore you automatically see some of them looking for funding, and there are angel investors who've been investing in other parts of the country and venture capital. So obviously the whole ecosystem is just starting to blossom now.
Yeah, so where do we stand as you know, the youth? Always we call our state as, you know, a place where intelligence are buzzing. So are we like getting up with the pace, or we are still not there yet?
No, I think we are followers.
We are followers?
Clearly, right? I mean, when you look at culture or look at language and you look at linguistics, all of these other areas, I think we are clearly the leaders. But I think in this one, which is the entrepreneurship ecosystem, the startup ecosystem, I think we are followers. I think it's a combination of things, right? The whole ecosystem has to surface. It starts with the entrepreneur who has a fantastic idea.
Okay.
So I think as far as technology is concerned, I think digital is concerned, right? So those ideas are now just starting to come forward. And so it's lagging from that point of view. And then along with that, there is a lag for the angel investors and then the venture capital. But I think certainly whenever there is a good idea and that will surface to the top, Kolkata will obviously then be part of the leadership.
So the mentoring here, do you think it's similar, the way people are mentored, the startups are mentored in Bangalore or in Bombay? Or in the mentoring also you feel that more participation is required?
I think it's easier here right now because it's a very early stage, right? It's an earlier stage than Bangalore, which is earlier stage than other places in the world. And therefore, to that extent, I think we are lucky and fortunate that mentors and advisors and investors, they will find that this is an early stage ecosystem, and therefore the very obvious answers are what are required. So whenever a technology entrepreneur comes forward, unlike in Bangalore where there is a certain level of maturity, people have gone through one or two startups already and failed, and so now they're on their second or third or fourth startup. Our youth typically by and large are the first time starters, and therefore the mentorship required is very basic. And which requires, you know, basic fundamentals about financial, you know, scalability in terms of the financials, model, investor readiness. And so some simple things, of course, the market size is also important. So understand that those who are focusing on Calcutta as a marketplace, Kolkata as a marketplace, or West Bengal as a marketplace, have a smaller, relatively smaller footprint. Compared to somebody who is in some place like Bangalore, who's focusing on India, or a financial capital like Bombay, Mumbai, right? So so I think each of those are nuances. Today, of course, the youth are smart. So hopefully they are working on an application or a use case, which goes across India.
Yes, I mean, all the startups that I meet, I mean, one of the cases in front of me, I've seen Wow Momo, Sagar. So other than Sagar, I hardly see anybody other than the tech startups are really flourishing. I mean, where are the, you know, challenges they are facing and how they should, you know, work around it? Because the youth that I meet, they always think of tech.
Yep.
And they're not going beyond tech. in startup? I mean,
I think you should simplify that as digital.
Digital.
I say the world is going digital.
Yes.
So I think it's the right thing for the youth here to focus on digital.
Okay.
You can't focus on a startup which is an infrastructured startup, right?
Okay.
Because those are all old school things.
Old school.
A young entrepreneur who is not affluent, right? They will obviously look at something which is like a digital, scalable, repeatable type of an application.
Okay.
And so for them, I think it is okay to focus on tech/digital, if I say so, right?
Okay.
But I think it is also part of the experience, right? To experience, which is a very thorough research. So people will start, let's say a fintech, right? Which is very popular, financial technology, fintech. So people will do some basic fintech applications.
Yes.
And then you find out that, oh, somebody is already doing it in Bangalore, or somebody has already done it in USA.
Yes.
So this is very basic, basic mistakes that people make, which is to not do a thorough research. You must do a thorough research, find out who else is doing it in India, who else is doing it all over the world. And if even if it is somebody, something that's successful in USA, and you can switch it and make a Indian version, what we call copy paste. But if it works here, why not, right? I mean, look at Flipkart. It ended up being a $16 billion exit, and people can say it's a copy paste, but it's a very successful copy paste.
So this startup ecosystem has actually changed the traditional way of doing business, and it is more profitable. So the traditional business houses are also coming into it.
Not as fast as we would like, so certainly not in Kolkata and West Bengal, but in India, yes. I think all of the big multinationals and the local nationals are all realizing that they need to be in it. So when many of the multinationals like Google, Facebook, Cisco, IBM, Intel, they are already in India, and they realize from their US experience and Europe experience and Asian experience, Southeast Asia, that they need to be here as well, and they need to promote this ecosystem. So they are certainly into it, and especially some of the venture arms of these people. So like, for example, there's Google Ventures and Facebook Ventures and Intel Capital, etc. Then now the national locals are also joining the game, because the national locals, so for example, people like Reliance, they'll want to, you know, get into this venture capital, and they want to do an M&A, they want to buy out some of these startups. So they are all getting involved.
So we all know about your intervention in getting IBM into India to restart. So if you can just share that story, how you did it and how that entire team was formed.
Sure. So I mean, first of all, I'm part of a team that got IBM started. So I was actually in IBM Houston, and I was in the process industry, in the oil industry, because Houston is obviously the oil sector. And so when I got this call, they said that we are going to restart India as a country. So IBM left India in 1978 due to the policies. IBM, Coke, all of these guys had left. So in 1988-89 time frame, IBM started looking at India again. But they didn't want to physically come onshore into India.
Okay.
So they actually wanted a team. And so when I got a call, they said we're going to start India as a country. I was not as interested, because I was not interested at that time to come and live in India and start it. But they said, oh no, this is starting from a place called Singapore. So I looked up Singapore on a map. I didn't know where it was. I had never been there. And so we ultimately ended up there. And so this offshore operation, it's called the IBM Offshore Operations.
Okay.
It got formed in Singapore.
Okay.
And we were four teams. And then I was one of those four teams. And then those four teams sitting in Singapore, we kept flying every other week to India over a period of 4 or 5 years. Till the whole IBM business grew enough to where IBM landed onshore into Bangalore. And that's how IBM India got started.
So I have read somewhere like IBM came to India along with Tata.
Correct. So right in the beginning, there was a joint venture which is called TISL.
Yeah.
And so the Tata IBM joint venture got started.
Okay.
And very soon thereafter, both IBM and Tata decided that IBM had a much bigger dreams of what they wanted to do, much bigger vision of what they wanted to do. And so the Tata exited out of it, and IBM became a 100% subsidiary, which is now IBM India, which has blossomed and mushroomed to the extent that it's hearsay that the number of employees in India for IBM is the largest in the world, even larger than IBM USA.
Yeah, correct. So from IBM, your journey started as a venture capitalist. How did you form that? What was your first break?
So there was an interim. So I didn't become a venture capital right after IBM.
Okay.
So when IBM asked me to move physically to Bangalore, when IBM physically went onshore in 1993, I had worked for 12 and a half years for IBM, and I decided that I didn't want to work anymore in India, in Bangalore, in IBM, I mean that combination. And I didn't want to go back to USA.
Okay.
So my family is in Singapore, and so we decided that, okay, I was going to quit and I was become an entrepreneur. you can call it a forced entrepreneur in a way. However, I'm the first generation in my entire family. I'm a Parekh Guju Baniya. So I have, nobody in my family has ever worked for anyone except my brother and me.
But the DNA works.
And so my brother and I, we were both very anxious and excited that at some point we would become independent on our own, because we were the first ones. And so when normally you tell your family that you're going to leave a job like IBM, people will fret. And in my case, people were saying, balle balle, which is fantastic, because you're going to become an independent entrepreneur now. So in 93, I quit IBM and I did 9 startups. And so my journey started from an entrepreneurship journey and ended up being a venture capital post 1 or 2 exits that I had. So I think the immediate break that I got, I started a software company, which I sold, and then with a partner and a good friend of mine, Balwant Singh. But the next break that I got was that a couple of my friends wanted to start a television channel. So they asked me if I wanted to be a part of that. And so I was independent at that point in time to say that, yes, okay, I'd be more than happy. I didn't know anything about television, but I still said that, yes, I'll jump in and I'll of course try and see what I can do to help out. So we actually, there was a story behind it. There were 7 of us who came together, including the guys.
I would like to know that story.
So again, that story is essentially, there's 2 friends of mine invited me. I invited another friend of mine, who's from IIM, IIT, and then Shemaru, so my friend and partner, Raman Maru. Huh. So he was part of that journey, and Jackie Shroff, the actor. So that's how the whole team of 7 of us got formed. And then we were going on our merry way trying to see if we can start a television channel called Ace TV. So that's what Ace TV, that's what we were trying to go after. But then Sony found us and they said that, you are a well-kept secret. Huh. And so we started the discussions and conversations, and they shortlisted 3 people. And we were one of the 3 people. And ultimately, after a long drawn out discussion, they picked us as a joint venture partner. And they and us built a joint venture, which is now ended up being what is called Sony Entertainment Television.
So guys, if you were wanting to know who are the brains behind Sony Entertainment Television, so here we have one of the founder with us. Lucky to have him here. So I'm sure it must be an incredible journey, because IPL is something which has created a roar. Sony.
Yeah, actually, so the journey started with one single general entertainment channel, which is called Sony, the main channel, the mainstream Sony one. And then from there, we thought that, okay, movies are very famous. So therefore, we did the Set Max channel. Yeah. And then we bought out Sub TV, right? So that's a comedy channel. So we bought that out. So over time, we started building that network. Yeah. And as we went along, and then we taught the Americans cricket. So they were all very amused, saying that, in baseball, you hit the ball and you run. Yes. Whereas in cricket, you block it and then how come people are not running between the wickets? So there was a lot of humor in the beginning, and they foo-fooed the whole game of cricket.
Okay.
But then we persisted and we told them, so you don't understand, there are basically only 3 big things in India. One of them is cricket, the other is Bollywood, and the third is religion. So I said, here, you really need to understand this game. Yeah. And so they kept at it, and they started to understand the statistics and the dynamics, and then they realized how big it is.
Yeah.
And so then we went after the World Cup cricket. So that World Cup cricket was the beginning of our cricket journey.
Okay.
So we usually get 2 World Cups and Champions Trophy, 4 Champions Trophy. You get that over a period of time.
Mm.
And so we did that, and we went and watched some of these World Cup cricket matches and really enjoyed that journey. And then when this whole idea of IPL happened, then Lalit is the guy who actually thought of this, and it was visionary, and along with our CEO, ex-CEO, Kunal Das Gupta. So the both of them actually cooked the whole thing up and cooked up a storm, convinced a whole bunch of people. And then, the rest is kind of history, where Sony took the first rights for a period of 10 years, which just, expired just recently. But that was a massive venture.
Yes, I think Sony has given a couple of, trend-setting examples, like Indian Idol.
Of course, Indian Idol was also, American Idol was then brought to India with the Indian Idol. And then we, of course, took Kaun Banega Crorepati also. So yes, I think that's really an IFA award.
IFA
I know that's also part of the Sony. So I think, yes, we had a lot of ups and downs going through this whole journey till we exited out of it in 2013. Now, of course, Sony is a very well-to-do and doing extremely well network.
So I happened to meet you in 2013, and that's where you have given me a lot of insight. And what I learned from you, your interest is more on social entrepreneur. So what is the analogy or logic behind that? Why social entrepreneur? Again, you always emphasize, and Akhanda Jyoti is what you're working on, is incredible.
I mean, so I think I'll go back and say that my first exposure to it came from recognizing that this is a network which is not fully exploited. So the social entrepreneurs, the NGO leaders, when I used to come to India and I see that they're all doing in their silos, they're doing all the independent work. And so we thought of a network which we, it's continuous, it's called ProPoor. So ProPoor was a portal which was started way back about 18, 19 years ago. And that was a repository of information on NGOs, as leaders and all of that. That's how my journey got started. And then over time, I became an angel investor. But one of the main areas that I focus on is social entrepreneurship. So social enterprise, which is doing good and making money. So it is a for-profit. And so I started investing in some social enterprises, and I also invested in a fund called Avishkar. So that was my journey.
Yes, Avishkar is something which people
correct.
Talk
so it's
about.
One of the, you know, pioneer in terms of social impact investing. In Vinitra is this founder and the CEO, and so now they are on fund three, and they also have a fund which is outside India on in Southeast Asia, Indonesia, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka. So again, that journey of impact investing really appealed to me, because I felt that I was doing good, but it was doing good and being well, and then whatever I made, I plowed it back into the system. So it was recycling, versus when you write a check to an NGO, the money just basically goes away one way. And there are different models, why some of them, the models are where you are a non-profit model and some are for-profit model, but the social entrepreneurship or social enterprise, which is social impact, that is at the base of it. So again, over time, I have really enjoyed that journey. And then just recently, over the past 1 year, I came across Mrityunjay Tiwari, who's the founder and the CEO of Akhand Jyoti Eye Hospital. So he's actually a soccer player from here. He's a football player. He was a Mohan Bagan football player here in Kolkata.
Wow.
And then after retiring, he decided, well, what am I going to do? He's from Bihar. So he went back to Mastichak, which is about 1 hour away from Patna. And so when he went back to Mastichak, he looked around and he tried to figure out that what am I going to do with my life? And so one of the things that he found was that there was early girl child marriage. There was a lot of rampant early girl child marriage in hinterlands of Bihar. And so he said, let me start what I know best, which is a football camp. So he started a soccer camp. Many of these young girls, they came to learn soccer. And some friend of his gave these girls a jersey, and suddenly it became very legit. A lot more girls came and they started playing soccer. So that was one thing. And on the other side, he saw that there's a lot of curable blindness that he can do some eye camps and eradicate that. So he started some eye camps, and that was a journey over the last 10 years. Fast forward now, he has just grown into an amazing social enterprise. It's a non-profit. It's called Akhand Jyoti Eye Hospital.
Yes.
And that Akhand Jyoti Eye Hospital today is a five-story hospital with 350 beds in Mastichak, which is, like I said, 1 hour away from Patna. And they do 65,000 cataract operations every year.
Every year.
Every year. And 80% of them for free. So,
you know,
so again,
that's
so there are
massive.
A few organizations that are supporting Akhand Jyoti. And so last year when Mrityunjay and friends asked me to be part of the advisory board, I absolutely was amazed when I visited Mastichak by the program and what they were doing. So I said yes. And over the last 1 year, I've been helping them with fundraising.
So what about this formation of Jungle Venture? It's like now globally, it's one of the top five. It's considered to be.
You're very kind. I guess in Silicon Valley, if you see, they are much, much different modes and the
but
and
Singapore
the size
is
scope.
Considered the Silicon Valley of Southeast Asia.
Fair enough.
Country.
I think it has progressed a lot.
Yeah.
And I think to that extent, we are extremely fortunate. We worked extremely hard. So two of my partners, Amit Anand and Anurag Srivastava, I introduced them, and I thought that they'd go away, and they went away, but they came back and said they'd be forming this venture fund called Jungle Ventures, and then would you please come and help us and be a managing partner as well. So I did you know, become a managing partner in Jungle Ventures Fund 2 and Fund 1 and 2 both. So I stayed with that. And then now in Fund 3, I'm going to become a senior advisor. We're just starting to do, you know, think about how to roll out Fund 3.
Great. So from entrepreneur and then social entrepreneur, you've been mentoring and people I see, the startup fraternity, the moment they hear Jayesh Parekh, they're like, wow. So what is this equation that you have with these startup entrepreneurs?
I think really the most important thing is the access, right? And I guess I haven't developed a certain level of arrogance that is usually there. There is a certain air about it that where people have a certain charismatic personality.
Yeah.
So I'm still trying to work on it. I still haven't figured out how to do that. And so maybe I'm very accessible, I'm available, and I'm easygoing.
Yeah.
And so people you know,
love
feel
that.
Comfortable. Yeah, they feel comfortable. And to an extent, they think I'm a money bag. So they also come to me because of that. They think I'm a money bag. And so, you know, I'm going to invest in every guy who walks through the door.
That is there with every venture capitalist. But I've seen that fondness that people talk like, okay, there are venture capitalists, angel investors, but there is Jayesh Parekh. So what is that different Jayesh Parekh?
I think I've drank the water of Kolkata. So I think there is a certain natural warmth. Like natural they say in Bengali, my thinking is Nimna Madhyabitto. So I'm a lower middle class value system. I've grown up in Bhavanipur, went to St. Lawrence High School. That DNA stayed with me.
Yeah.
And so however money you pile on me, there's basic Jayesh Parekh, Mool Swarup doesn't change, right? So this is who I am.
So these are your professional achievements and your life successes. What is the other side of Jayesh Parekh that we can...
I think it's minimalist now. I think going forward, I'm really looking forward to a second innings, as they call it. So the first innings was commercial and I flipped that over. So I want to spend more time on nonprofit. I want to spend more time on social entrepreneurship. So I want to do a lot more things which are non-commercial because I have a theory which says that, okay, so you work hard all your life to make money. Okay, and then when you make money, then you work hard to make money on your money and then you die. And I don't want to live that life. So I've worked very hard, I've made some money, but I don't want to work for the rest of my life making money on my money. So I think I'm discovering myself, I'm discovering a journey which is just completely different. It's sort of minimalizing my time. I'm working on something which is called time affluence, right? So I have a lot of time affluence. I don't want to cramp up my time from morning 8 to evening 8. I'm just constantly running around, chasing things, mentoring people, advising people or helping people and also investing in people and investing my money and constantly trying to do that. I think I'm minimalizing that. So I spend quality time and I discriminate. So I'm discovering self-love. And so I do practice that as much as I can. And I'm trying to find time affluence. I think the next thing after time affluence is mind affluence.
How would you do that?
And I have no idea.
If you can give us some tips. Because
when I figure it out, please invite me again. Voice of Republic. Please invite me again the next time.
Sure, right? We would love to.
So right now I'm practicing time affluence. And then once I go past it, mind affluence is basically exactly what it says, right? You can't be cramped. You've got millions of thoughts all the time. You're thinking about something or the other.
The ideas keep popping up.
It's not only ideas, right? There are natural things that pop into people's mind, right? Young guys have hormonal flares. Entrepreneurs are thinking of how to make their ideas work. Affluent people have some different things that are constantly going through their mind. What is the Forex doing? What is this Apple stock doing? Google Fang stocks doing? Constantly people are kind of ideating and trying to figure out. And then once you make it, then people are trying to find philosophies that they are proud of. So whether it's an investment philosophy.
One thing that I really learned from you you travel and you explore. You explore people, you explore places. You are an explorer. So like there is a spiritual journey also which you are going through, which I have also learned a lot of things from you. So if you can just enlighten these young entrepreneurs that what are the balances they should keep in mind while progressing in their professional field.
Yeah, I think that is really the balance, right? Ultimately, it's the balance. The pillars of balance is that one is your work, right? Whether you're working for someone or you're an entrepreneur, right? That's one part of it. The second part of it is that you're trying to see if you can give back to the community. So that's the services, right? And then the third is spiritual, right? So the spiritual pillar, and that spiritual pillar comes to different people in a different way. Some are extremely religious, right? Some are ritualistic religious, some people are spiritual, and some people are agnostic or even atheist. And again, everyone is discovering themselves in that journey, and that's the spiritual journey.
So it's lovely and wonderful, Jayesh, to have this conversation in front of the camera, and we are looking forward to have you over again with more of your insights and a lot of other informations about the startup ecosystem. So any message that you would like to give to the Kolkata startup ecosystem and what they should look forward to and how they should develop themselves?
I think most important thing is to take risk. If you can't take risk, then you're just going to be sitting on the harbor. A ship was not supposed to be docked in the harbor. The ship was supposed to go and sail. So take risk, go sail, explore. Don't be afraid of failure. But I think the world has got huge opportunity out there. Just go and soar.
So guys, don't be a typical Bengali. Let us explore, right?
Absolutely. Good luck. And really, thank you so much, Voice of Republic, for inviting me here today. And I really enjoyed my conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Of course.